pray together the introit. I will sing of the steadfast love of the Lord forever. Blessed are the people who know the festal shout,
who walk the Lord in the light of your face,
who exult in your name all the day,
and in your righteousness are exalted.
For you are the glory of their strength.
By your favor our opponents exalted.
For our shield belongs to the Lord. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. I will sing of the steadfast love of the Lord forever. The Old Testament reading for the fourth Sunday after Pentecost comes from Jeremiah chapter 28. Then the prophet Jeremiah spoke to Hananiah, the prophet, in the presence of the priests, and all the people who were standing in the house of the Lord. And the prophet Jeremiah said, Amen. May the Lord do so. May the Lord make the words that you have prophesied come true, and bring back to this place from Babylon the vessels of the house of the Lord, and all the exiles. Yet hear now this word, and I speak in your hearing, and in the hearing of all the people. The prophets who preceded you and me from ancient times prophesied war, famine, and pestilence against many countries and great kingdoms. As for the prophet who prophesies peace, when the word of that prophet comes to pass, then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent the prophet. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us. Our epistle lesson comes from Romans chapter 7. Do you not know, brothers, for I am speaking to those who know the law, that the law is binding on a person only as long as he lives? Thus a married woman is bound by law to her husband while he lives. But if her husband dies, she is released from the law of marriage. Accordingly, she will be called an adulteress if she lives with another man while her husband is alive. But if her husband dies, she is free from that law. And if she marries another man, she is not an adulteress. Likewise, my brothers, you also have died to the law through the body of Christ, so that you may belong to another, to him who has been raised from the dead, in order that we may bear fruit for God. For while we were living in the flesh, our sinful passions, aroused by the law, were at work in our members to bear fruit for death. But now we are released from the law, having died to that which held us captive, so that we serve not under the old written code, but in the new life of the Holy Spirit. What then shall we say? That the law is sin? By no means. Yet if it had not been for the law, I would not have known sin. I would not have known what it is to covet if the law had not said, You shall not covet. But sin, seizing an opportunity through the commandment, produced in me all kinds of covetousness. Apart from the law, sin lies dead. I was once alive apart from the law, but when the commandment came, sin came, alive and I died. The very commandment that promised life proved to be death to me. For sin, seizing an opportunity through the commandment, deceived me and through it killed me. So the law is holy and the commandment is holy and righteous and good. did that which is good then bring death to me? By no means. It was sin producing death in me through what is good, in order that sin might be shown to be sin, and through the commandment might become sinful beyond all measure. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us. Please rise out of reverence for the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 10th chapter. Jesus said, "Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a person's enemies will be those of his own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Whoever receives you receives me, and whoever receives me receives him who sent me. The one who receives a prophet because he is a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And the one who receives a righteous person because he is a righteous person will receive a righteous person's reward. And whoever gives one of these little ones even a cup of cold water because he is a disciple, truly I say to you, he will by no means lose his reward. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us. We now sing the hymn of the day, Let Us Ever Walk with Jesus. God's grace, his mercy, and peace be multiplied to you, friends and fellow Christians. Amen. I have come not to bring peace, but a sword. With hard sayings like these, our old Adams very often say, I wish Jesus hadn't said that. I like Christmas, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. I like Christmas, especially if you leave out the slaughter of the innocents. I love Easter too. Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. I love Easter, but our old Adam really says, I wish Jesus hadn't said, I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother. A person's enemies will be those of his own household. Wasn't Jesus' mission to bring peace and goodwill toward men? Didn't the angels say that in the Christmas story? But Jesus says, not peace, but a sword. Sword means warfare, bloodshed, death. And this seems to contradict everything that Jesus says about his mission elsewhere. He tells you to turn the other cheek, but he's bringing a sword to the battle. He tells you to go, if someone asks you to go 1 mile, go with them too. But now he brings conflict and division. What is going on here? Perhaps the first thing to note is that Jesus says, do not think I have come to bring peace. Do not think, because that's exactly what we do think. That the Christian life will be a life of peace. Now, it will be a peace in a sense, but we often think it is peace in the sense that if I do what I am supposed to do, if I remain faithful, if I keep my room clean, if I give all over to God, he will bless my efforts. He will provide me with what I want, and he will give me peace. Or maybe just leave me alone, and that would be enough. Jesus says, do not think this. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. What is this? And why does Jesus bring a sword, and in the same breath, start talking about fathers and mothers, brothers and sisters, husbands and wives? Isn't family life complicated enough already? The answer is simple. He says this in order to save you. Now, what do I mean by that? I mean Jesus must first separate us from all that we fear and love and trust in this world so that we will fear, love, and trust in him above all things. Everything we have in this life, including family, is a gift from God. What Jesus is telling us about these gifts, even the most basic and fundamental gift, like family, is that they must not surpass the giver of the gift. Family must not be preferred over the giver of family, who is God. Now, does this mean that families are not important to Jesus? Does this mean that we should not honor our fathers and mothers, and that we should not love our spouses selflessly? Certainly not. Jesus greatly honored his earthly father, Joseph, and when he was dying, Jesus thought about who would take care of his mom. Families are important to Jesus, and we will talk about that in a moment. But first, I want to draw your attention to the fact that Jesus is not making up these words on the spot, but he is quoting from the prophet Micah. Micah wrote, "Put no trust in a neighbor. Have no confidence in a friend. Guard the doors of your mouth from her who lies in your arms. For the son treats the father with contempt, and the daughter rises up against her mother. A daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. A man's enemies are the men of his own house. But as for me, I will look to the Lord. I will look to God, the God of my salvation. My God will hear me." When Jesus quotes these words, he is not saying that he has come to be a home wrecker. That's not what God wants. The same God that said a man's enemies will be in his household also gave the fourth commandment to protect the institution of the family. By quoting these verses, Jesus is saying that the promised salvation Micah spoke about 700 years earlier is here in him. And Jesus warns Christians against the dangers of having a non-Christian family. The Christian must not deny Christ for the sake of familial bliss. The Christian cannot choose the gift over the giver of the gift. And we can broaden Jesus' words out to the fact that families should not be your chief object of trust or faith. Your family will let you down. As strong as your family may be, as wonderful as your husband might be, as wonderful as your wife might be, your husband is going to let you down. Your wife is going to let you down. Your children are going to let you down. Even if they are faithfully devoted to you all their lives, they cannot help you after you die or they die. And those are the good families. Many families are not so good. Put no trust in them, Micah says. Know that they are going to fail you. But as for me, I look to the Lord, the God of my salvation. Now, I'm going to just as an aside here, mention that God is not only saying these words about your eternal life, but he is also speaking about your life here and now for the sake of saving your life with your family here and now. If you turn your husband into a god or your wife into a goddess, you will end up thoroughly disappointed with your husband and disillusioned with your wife. They will fail you. Husbands and wives make wonderful helpmates, but terrible gods. And children, well, they make tyrants if you make them your idol. Our hearts are idol factories and will make idols of anything. They easily turn family into an idol because it is such a good gift of God. As Christians, we know we shouldn't idolize fame or power or money. But we see the goodness of family, and our sinful hearts make it into an idol. However, ultimately, only the true God will not fail you. And that is exactly who is standing there with the disciples. Jesus Christ, the true God of their salvation. He has come to help his people, and he alone is worthy of our complete trust. Where others fail us, our Savior doesn't fail us. And yet sometimes it does seem like it, doesn't it? When hardships come, when diseases strike, when life deals you a job loss or low soybean market prices, when civilians face police brutality or innocents get hurt in riots, it is easy to be discouraged and think that God has let us down. It seems as if he is not giving us what we need and not providing for our loved ones. This is the hard part, and that's why we have to hear it and contemplate this when we are not under duress, so that when a crisis does come into our lives and all the gifts that God has given us seem to disappear, we will have already given it some serious thought. Have we grown reliant on that which we should not have? Have we begun to fear and love and trust the good gifts as opposed to the good giver? The price is huge when we trust the gifts instead of the giver, and then experience the failure of those gifts to save. The price is disappointment, despair, discouragement, dejection, and doubt. The only price that can save us is what our Savior has come to pay. The other gifts cannot do it. Only the God of our salvation, who has come in the person of Jesus Christ, can pay the price for our life. He laid down his life on the cross to separate us from our sins as far as the east is from the west, to give us life. For every man and every woman and for every child, he has come to save. He died and rose again so that we could not only be saved by grace through faith in the forgiveness of sins, but also so that we can live a new life in him, a life that doesn't give undue trust to earthly fathers, but trust our heavenly Father. A life that does not trust earthly brothers and sisters, but trusts our new brother, Jesus Christ. Now, are we worthy of this? Of what Christ has done? To be called sons and daughters of God and brothers and sisters of Jesus? Not at all. Whoever loves father and mother more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever loves son and daughter more than me is not worthy of me. We fail to fear, love, and trust in God above all things. We, or maybe just I, you can decide if this applies to you also. I love my father and my mother, and my wife and my children, perhaps with unwarranted devotion. And yet the worthiness of Christ is greater than my unworthiness, and it is greater than your unworthiness too. The love of Christ is greater than our sin. Even though not one of us is worthy, still our Father calls us his children, constantly forgiving us and restoring us to the family of God. And all this he does from the cross. First, the cross of Christ, and then from the cross he places on each one of us. Whoever does not pick up his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life will find it. The cross is God's gracious means of restoration. Only through death and resurrection do we have the forgiveness of our sins and restoration of life. And by bearing the cross we have been given, we share in the death and resurrection of Jesus. In Jesus' day, to carry the cross was to die. To carry the cross was to be heading towards your execution. The cross was intended to kill you. And so when Jesus here talks about bearing your cross, he is not just talking about some suffering that he wants you to endure, but he is talking about your death. Your death and resurrection in him, so that you can live a new life. Not just in the resurrection of the last day, but also here and now. Remember what Paul told the Romans. Do you not know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. That's the goal of all Jesus did for us, that we might die and rise again. Die to sin and live to him. Die to our old life and live a new life. Die to reliance on ourselves and what we can do, and live by trusting what he has done. That's exactly what happened when you were baptized. You died and rose again with your Savior. Now you bear the cross so that dying and rising might be a daily occurrence in your life. That's why the cross is given to you, not to be a burden to you or make you suffer, but to kill you. Kill you by daily repentance, that's so that the new man can arise in you. Arise in you through the forgiveness of sins that God has granted to you. That sounds sort of like what Luther says in the Small Catechism. Baptism, what does such baptizing with water indicate? Answer, it indicates that the old Adam in us should by daily contrition and repentance be drowned and die with all sins, evil desires, that a new man should daily emerge and arise to live before God in righteousness and purity forever. And that sword which Jesus speaks of, it's the sword of his word. Through his word preached into your ears, through his word poured over you in the waters of holy baptism, through his word placed on your tongue at the altar, you are absolved and given the forgiveness of sins. They forgive you. You know what restoration of life comes when you have sinned against someone and they forgive you. When they forgive you completely and drop the charges completely and do not hold your sin against you. You know what new life is granted to you in forgiveness. Peace with the world. Peace while we still are living in our sins. Peace while trusting in those who cannot save us. What kind of peace is that? That's the frail and fleeting peace that the world gives that never lasts. But through the cross and the sword of his word, Christ gives us everlasting peace. Just when you think your life is lost, you find it. For your life is hidden with Christ in God. That's the message the disciples were sent out to proclaim, and it's the message we are to proclaim as well. A message of sword and cross and life to a world that is looking for life and meaning and purpose, but does not know where to look or where to find it. So the disciples and now the church are sent by Jesus as Jesus was first sent by his Father to show forth that light. In bearing our cross, we show forth that light to the world that needs to see that light. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. The ushers may come forward to receive the offering.
please rise for the singing of our canticle hymn. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near to the Lord's throne of grace and pray as he has commanded us, trusting in the Lord's mercy to hear the prayers of his people and answer our petitions according to his mercy. O most merciful God, Lord of heaven and earth, we pray you to so rule and govern your church and all her pastors and ministers, that she may be preserved in the pure doctrine of your saving word. Defend against all adversity and protected from all adversities, that thereby faith may be strengthened and love increased in us. Lord, in your mercy, grant health, wisdom, and integrity to all in authority over us, especially to the President of the United States, the Governor of Ohio and Governors of Ohio and Indiana, the Congress, all legislative bodies, and all judges and magistrates. Endow them with your spirit and with respect for your word, that they would serve at your good pleasure for the maintenance of righteousness and the punishment of wickedness, so that we all may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and honesty. According to your gracious will, turn the hearts of our enemies and make them to walk with us in humility and peace. Lord, in your mercy, grant to those in trouble, want, sickness, and anguish of labor, peril of death, or any other adversity, the healthful spirit of your grace, for healing, strength, comfort, and relief. Bless those who suffer for the sake of your name and your word. Merciful Lord, give them courage to stand firm in their afflictions and patience until the delay of your deliverance. Lord, in your mercy, preserve us from pestilence and every evil. Give to us favorable weather and cause the fruits of the earth to prosper, that we may enjoy them in due season and offer you praise and thanksgiving for all your goodness to us. Lend your blessing to all honorable vocations and honest industry, that we may serve where our skills and abilities may be of good use. Bless, guard, and guide those in the armed forces as they serve to protect us. Lord, in your mercy, all these things for which you have us ask of you, we pray you to grant to us for the sake of the bitter sufferings and death of Jesus Christ our Lord, whom we are bold to call you Father, in whose name we pray, trusting in your mercy and confident that you will give answer to our prayers. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Trusting in his promises, we are bold to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Let us pray.
O Lord, our heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, who has safely brought us to the beginning of this day, defend us in the same with thy mighty power, and grant that this day we fall into no sin, neither run into any kind of danger, but that all our doings being ordered in thy governance may be righteous in thy sight. Through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee, and the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end.
Bless we the Lord.
Praise be to God.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all.
Thank you.
guys this morning while Pastor Patterson was out. You guys didn't say it. It's just an announcement. While Pastor Patterson is out, we pray his vocation goes well. I'll be with you through all of next month, and I think he's back the first weekend in August. So you'll be seeing a lot of